Good evening, everyone, and welcome. I gather that there'll be more people streaming in as we begin here, but I think it's good to set a precedent early on for on-time departures, and so we'll do our best here this evening. My name is Sam Raskoff. I teach national security law here at the law school, and I'm also the faculty director of the Center on Law and Security. In just a minute or two, we're going to hear from someone who is a consummate lawyer statesman and someone who is going to be speaking about a set of issues that could hardly be more topical or more urgent, namely U.S. policy in respect to sanctions on Iran. But before Undersecretary Cohen takes the podium here, I wanted to note just a couple of milestones in the history of the Center on Law and Security that are taking place this evening. First, tonight is the center's kickoff event this academic year. As many of you probably know, the center's been around since 2003 and has played a crucial role over the last decade in shaping the legal and policy debates surrounding the post-9/11 world in which we've been living ever since. The center has done pioneering work on issues such as detention and interrogation, and has really contributed not just to the academic discourse, but to the public discourse about these hugely consequential issues. Tonight, we inaugurate, in a sense, the second iteration of the center, the 2.0 version of the center, in which the center is going to start to turn its attention to the next set, the next generation of post-9/11 national security law challenges, whether having to do with the relationship between law and strategy, the role of the private sector in performing national security functions in the United States, and the role of global national security law, in which we hope to engage in a sustained dialogue with partners from around the world in sharing lessons learned and really trying to take note of how different societies have grappled with these challenges that are common to many of them. So that's all new on the center's front. Also new this evening is the center's executive director, Zach Goldman, who joined us just a couple of months ago. Zach, I am pleased to report, is a graduate of this law school. In fact, he was a student of mine, and a terrific student at that. After graduating from the law school here at NYU, he went to work for Undersecretary Cohen, our speaker this evening at the Treasury, focusing on issues of counterterrorism finance and Iran sanctions, and also did a stint at the Pentagon, where he served as a special assistant to the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. In short, and without being too gushing, Zach really is a rising star in the national security firmament, and has already really begun to take the reins of the center and move it in a terrific new direction, along with his partner in crime, Sarvanaz Bakhtiar, who is somewhere here and has been keeping our center afloat for the last 3 years, and really doing so in an inimitably thoughtful and knowing way. So thanks to both of you. We have a terrific set of programs set for this coming year. Just to give you one coming attraction, on October 10th, the center's very distinguished fellow, President Dorit Beinish, the recently retired Chief Justice of the State of Israel, who's with us this evening sitting here, will be in dialogue with University Professor Jeremy Waldron. President Beinish, as you might expect, having been the Chief Justice of Israel, has seen her fair share of national security matters from the standpoint of a judge, but also had an enormously distinguished career as a government lawyer across many decades before she even joined the court. So that will be a real attraction this semester. There'll be other programs that will be similarly illuminating and provocative. So we encourage all of you to keep abreast of what we're doing on our website and through email, and to become serial participants in Center on Law and Security events. Well, we're going to turn to our main event now. And to introduce Undersecretary Cohen, I'd like us to all give a warm welcome to Zach Goldman, the new Center on Law and Security Executive Director.
Good evening. Thank you. As you all know by now, my name is Zachary Goldman. I'm the new executive director of the Center on Law and Security, and it's a real pleasure for me to be here this evening. It's a pleasure because it's our first event of what promises to be a very exciting year, but an even greater pleasure because of who our guest this evening is. David Cohen is the Undersecretary of the Treasury for Terrorism and Financial Intelligence. He was confirmed in this role by the Senate in June of 2011 after having served as the Assistant Secretary of Terrorist Financing and Financial Crimes for 2 years and previously as a partner with the law firm of WilmerHale. He leads the group at the Treasury Department that is charged with disrupting the financial support networks of illicit actors like terrorist groups and WMD proliferators. He and his team bring the weight of the U.S. financial system to bear on those who pose a threat to our nation. I have had, as Professor Raskoff said, the great pleasure of working for Undersecretary Cohen and know that there's no finer and more dedicated public servant. Over the last several years, Undersecretary Cohen and the Treasury Department have made innovative use of financial measures to respond to the uprisings in Libya and Syria and to starve al-Qaeda of resources. But perhaps the most difficult challenge has been to prevent Iran from using the international financial system to obtain the goods and financing it needs to develop its nuclear program. The topic of his remarks this evening, the law and policy of Iran sanctions, could not be more timely. The web of legal and policy tools that Undersecretary Cohen will describe has succeeded not only in putting tremendous economic pressure on Iran, but also in assembling an unprecedented global coalition to do so. And as tensions with Iran are unfortunately escalating, there is nobody better positioned to describe our country's efforts to induce Iran to engage in meaningful negotiations regarding its nuclear program. It is my great pleasure to introduce the Undersecretary of the Treasury for Terrorism and Financial Intelligence, David Cohen.
Good evening, and thank you, Sam. Thank you, Zach, for that really gracious introduction. Only sorry my mother wasn't here to hear you call me the consummate lawyer and statesman, so I will have to ask you to repeat that for her at some point. It really is a great pleasure to be here at the Center on Law and Security at NYU School of Law. Having spent 20 years practicing law before I entered the Obama administration, it's a real treat to be able to speak to an audience composed of law professors, lawyers, and especially aspiring lawyers. Before I turn to the main topic for this evening, I do want to pause for a moment to recognize and remember what transpired 11 years ago yesterday, just about 2 miles from here. The horrific attacks of 9/11 had a profound impact on our nation and on our world, on our sense of security and on how we go about protecting our country. It spawned some good things, such as this center and the good work that it has done. But it is an enduring mark and something that I think is important for us to pause and remember. And sadly, as we pause to reflect tonight on the tragic deaths of those who were killed on September 11th, 2001, I think we also need to pause and mourn the loss of four Americans, including Ambassador Chris Stevens, who were killed in Benghazi, Libya yesterday. Ambassador Stevens, who I knew, and the other Americans who lost their lives in Libya were dedicated public servants. And as the president said today, they exemplified America's commitment to freedom, justice, and partnership with nations and people around the globe. Their deaths are an enormous loss for the United States and a reminder of the sacrifices Americans make every day around the world in the service of our country and our values. With this tragedy in mind, I hope my remarks tonight and discussion that follows will shed some light on the work the Department of the Treasury is doing as part of these broader U.S. government efforts to keep our country safe and to promote peace and security around the world. The office that I lead in the Department of the Treasury, the Office of Terrorism and Financial Intelligence, was created to better organize and align our government's efforts to combat terrorism and other national security threats. As Zach described, my job is to combat illicit finance, such as fundraising by terrorist organizations and their supporters, money laundering by drug cartels and transnational criminal organizations, and illicit financial transactions that facilitate nuclear and ballistic missile programs. Along with an extraordinarily talented and dedicated group of intelligence analysts, policy advisors, sanctions investigators, and regulators, we work to disrupt these illicit networks, protect the integrity of the U.S. and international financial systems, and advance core national security and foreign policy interests of the United States. And I'm so proud that one of our alumni, Zach Goldman, who contributed in so many spectacular ways to our mission, is now the executive director in this center. You're all very lucky to have him. As the Undersecretary for Terrorism and Financial Intelligence, one of my key responsibilities is developing and overseeing the implementation of economic and financial sanctions programs. And although we have been using sanctions for many years against terrorist financiers and WMD proliferators, the last several years have seen a burst of intensity and creativity as we have developed and deployed new sanctions against such diverse targets as Assad's regime in Syria, transnational criminal groups like the Brothers Circle and the Yakuza, and of course, Iran. So this evening, I'd like to focus my remarks on our use of financial pressure in an effort to persuade Iran's leadership to change its calculus about its nuclear program. Speaking about this topic in a law school is particularly appropriate, because we have used a variety of legal tools, some of them that are quite innovative, to generate this financial pressure. No one questions that Iran is one of the most pressing national security issues of our day. Iran remains the world's leading state sponsor of terrorism, sending money and weapons to extremists across the globe. The Iranian regime routinely abuses the human rights of its citizens, while it exports repression through its Quds Force, by supporting Hamas and Hezbollah, and most recently by providing critical assistance to the Assad regime in its brutal attacks on the Syrian people. And its nuclear program threatens the peace and security of the entire Middle East and beyond. Since coming into office in 2009, this administration has pursued a dual-track strategy in an effort to resolve the Iranian nuclear issue. From the first days of the administration, we extended a sincere offer of diplomatic engagement to Iran, providing Iran with a path to reclaim its place among the community of nations. At the same time, we made clear that if Iran refused the offer of engagement, we, along with our partners in the international community, would steadily yet rapidly apply increasingly powerful and sophisticated sanctions on Iran. We are working to make the choice for the Iranian leadership as stark as possible between genuine engagement on the one hand and an ever-increasing financial and economic pressure on the other hand, so that the Iranian government recognizes that there is only one real option to address in a meaningful and concrete fashion the international community's very serious concerns about its nuclear program. As I'm sure you know, thus far the Iranian leadership has not taken the opportunity it has been offered. And as a result, over the last few years, we have crafted and implemented a series of sanctions, some in conjunction with our international partners, some that are complementary to steps taken by others, that have very substantially ratcheted up the pressure on Iran. Let me begin by giving you a sense of the impact that these sanctions are having on Iran today. Put simply, the Iranian economy is struggling. In part, this is due to the Iranian government's continued gross mismanagement of its domestic economy. And in part, it is due to the effect of sanctions pressure. Sanctions have hit Iran's oil sector, by far its most important industry, hard over the past year. Historically, oil exports comprised 80% of the Iranian government's foreign exchange earnings and provided about two-thirds of its budget revenue. Last year, Iran exported approximately 2.4 million barrels of oil per day to about 20 countries, making it the third largest oil exporter in the world and earning it about $100 billion from oil sales. As a result of actions taken since the beginning of this year, Iran's crude exports have plummeted to approximately 1 million barrels per day, a dramatic 55% decrease. This decrease in exports is costing Iran about $5 billion a month, forcing the Iranian government to cut its budget because of a lack of revenue. Compounding this severe loss of revenue, Iran has also lost access to the modern international banking system. Sanctions have effectively terminated international access for most Iranian banks, and this has had a number of important effects. With its banks increasingly unable to finance trade or process international payments, it has become ever more difficult for Iran to conduct business beyond its borders. It has also made it much more difficult for the Iranian government to access the revenue it is still able to earn from its oil sales, multiplying the revenue loss from reduced sales volumes. Today, the Iranian government is relegated to the backwaters of the international financial system, and they know it. Earlier this year, Iranian President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad lamented that, quote, "Iranian banks cannot make international transactions anymore." And just last week, he said the sanctions are, quote, "blocking off conduits, like the conduits of selling oil and accessing foreign exchange." Perhaps the most dramatic reflection of the impact of financial sanctions can be seen in the plummeting value of Iran's currency, the rial. Over the past 12 months, the rial has lost more than half of its value against the dollar. At this time last year, it took about 12,000 rials to buy a dollar. Last Sunday, it took 26,000 rials. As its wealth has evaporated, the Iranian government has tried in vain to stem the decline of the rial, including attempts to shut down the currency exchange market in Tehran. Macroeconomic indicators tell a similar story of economic distress. According to the CBI's own calculations, Iran's official inflation rate is 27%. And with the rial plummeting, inflation is likely to rise much higher. The unemployment rate is officially estimated to be 17%, although again, it is likely significantly higher. And according to the IMF, Iran's GDP growth this year was projected to be only 0.4%. The decline in Iran's oil receipts may well yield negative GDP growth. In any event, it will be down substantially from about 10% growth just 5 years ago, and far below the performance of neighboring oil exporting countries. The financial and commercial effects of the sanctions, combined with the Iranian government's economic mismanagement, are beginning to affect Iran's domestic politics. Most notably, in July, the Supreme Leader, who had previously brushed off sanctions, acknowledged, quote, pressures, and urged Iranians to adopt what he called an economy of resistance, including such policies as, quote, correcting consumption methods to limit demand, while also, quote, reducing Iran's dependence on oil for revenue. Clearly, the Iranian government now faces a complex and daunting set of economic challenges, unquestionably due in part to the impact of sanctions. To understand how we have arrived at this point and why we have arrived at this point, I want to trace for you the arc of these efforts and point out some of the notable changes in how we have gone about applying pressure on Iran, all in service of the administration's overarching objective of preventing Iran from acquiring a nuclear weapon. When the Obama administration came into office in 2009, we inherited the fruits of several years of strong U.S. efforts to apply pressure to Iran on three fronts. First, there was the near total U.S. embargo on financial and commercial relationships with Iran. For close to two decades, American banks have been largely forbidden from transacting directly with all Iranian banks, including the Central Bank of Iran. American businesses have been forbidden from buying just about anything from or selling just about anything to Iran. And American oil companies have been forbidden from importing oil from Iran. Second, we inherited a UN sanctions framework that imposed multilateral sanctions on Iran. A series of Security Council resolutions beginning in 2006 not only highlighted serious concerns with Iran's nuclear program and demanded that Iran halt its uranium enrichment activities, but they also imposed sanctions against dozens of individuals, firms, and Iranian government entities involved in its nuclear and ballistic missile programs, including one major Iranian state-owned bank. And third, employing a targeted, conduct-based sanction strategy in which we took action against particular parties involved in illicit activity, Treasury had imposed sanctions by 2009 on more than a dozen Iranian banks. These targeted actions barred U.S. persons from transacting with these designated banks and froze any of their assets that were in the United States. But just as importantly, they exposed the illicit activities of those banks subject to sanctions. Through a vigorous outreach and education effort, my predecessors at Treasury made certain that the international business community, and in particular global banks, were made aware of these illicit financial activities. And although foreign banks are not generally obligated to abide by these sanctions, they reach only U.S. persons and those operating in the U.S., many foreign banks, acting out of enlightened self-interest to protect their reputations, chose to terminate relationships with sanctioned Iranian banks. By 2009, these efforts clearly had begun to have an impact on Iran. Not only did they disrupt the activities of those who were sanctioned, but we saw a growing economic impact on Iran, particularly as many of its banks found it increasingly difficult to transact internationally. When President Obama took office, these efforts continued unabated, and indeed have been expanded significantly. At the same time, President Obama put a newfound emphasis on the engagement track of the dual-track strategy. From his very first months in office, the president put forward a very clear choice to the Iranian regime, a path that would allow them to rejoin the community of nations if they meet their international obligations, or a path that leads to an escalating series of consequences if they don't. By late 2009, it was clear that Iran was not, at that point at least, prepared to engage meaningfully with the international community. This was demonstrated most plainly by the disclosure in September 2009 that Iran had begun work in secret on a new Iranian enrichment facility at Fordo. And it was confirmed later that fall when Iran at first accepted and then rejected a deal to exchange its stockpile of enriched uranium for the nuclear fuel that it needed to manufacture medical isotopes at the Tehran Research Reactor. It was time to sharpen the choice further for Iran's leadership by developing and implementing truly biting sanctions against Iran. We did this in two principal ways, both of which broke new ground. First, remaining faithful to our conduct-based targeted sanctions approach, we took aim directly at Iran's central bank. We did so both because the CBI was complicit in illicit activity of Iran's designated banks, and thus fair game under a conduct-based approach, and also because it was a key node in Iran's receipt of oil revenue, and thus a particularly attractive target for sanctions. Second, we amplified our efforts to isolate Iran's designated banks. Moving beyond our appeal to foreign banks' enlightened self-interest, we took a series of actions that conditioned foreign banks' direct access to the U.S. financial market on their agreement not to deal with Iran's designated banks. The first indication of this new approach can be seen in UN Security Council Resolution 1929, adopted in June 2010. Like prior Iran-related resolutions adopted by the Security Council, Resolution 1929 called on Iran to demonstrate the exclusively peaceful nature of its nuclear program and to suspend enrichment activities. It also imposed sanctions on individuals and entities involved in Iran's nuclear and ballistic missile programs. But most importantly, Resolution 1929 laid the groundwork for the enhanced sanctions measures that the U.S. and others have put in place over the past 2 years. In its preamble, Resolution 1929 spoke of the need for member states to, quote, exercise vigilance over transactions involving Iranian banks, including the Central Bank of Iran, so as to prevent such transactions contributing to proliferation-sensitive nuclear activities or to the development of nuclear weapon delivery systems. It also, quote, noted the potential connection between Iran's revenues derived from its energy sector and the funding of Iran's proliferation-sensitive nuclear activities. In doing so, the Security Council highlighted for the first time the importance of Iran's energy sector revenues and its central bank to its proliferation activities. Second, the resolution contains several hooks that set the stage for direct action to restrict Iran's international banking access. It did so by calling on member states to prevent their banks from providing any financial services to Iran, including allowing correspondent accounts between their banks and Iranian banks, or allowing Iranian banks to open new branches in their jurisdictions if there are, quote, reasonable grounds to believe that these financial services, quote, could contribute to Iran's nuclear or missile programs. Now, you are all lawyers, or someday soon will be. Take a moment to ponder that evidentiary standard. Reasonable grounds to believe that financial services could contribute to Iran's proliferation activities. As an abstract matter, that is not a terribly difficult standard to meet. And as a practical matter, we had a wealth of information that demonstrated how Iranian banks abused their financial access to facilitate Iran's proliferation activities, often using deceptive practices to try to mask the involvement of designated proliferators and other illicit actors. So with the financial provisions of Resolution 1929 as a foundation, we shared our information about Iran's illicit and deceptive practices with our partners around the world. And in the summer and fall of 2010, the EU, the UK, Japan, South Korea, Canada, Australia, Norway, and Switzerland all took robust action to restrict Iran's banking activities. Other nations took less formal or public, but still very strong steps against Iranian financial activity in the wake of Resolution 1929. As Resolution 1929 was being drafted and adopted at the United Nations, here at home, we worked closely with Congress to craft what is known as the Comprehensive Iran Sanctions Accountability and Divestment Act, better known as SASADA, which the President signed into law on July 1st, 2010. SASADA set a new precedent. It gave the Secretary of the Treasury the authority for the first time to acquire U.S. banks to terminate correspondent banking relationships with foreign banks that knowingly engaged in significant transactions with those designated Iranian banks. This is a particularly powerful provision. Access to the U.S.-based banks is critically important for many foreign banks because their ability to offer dollar-denominated services to their clients depends on their ability to clear dollar transactions through banks in the U.S. Without access to the U.S. financial system, a foreign bank's ability to service its customers is significantly limited. So SASADA required foreign banks to consider much more than the reputational risk involved in dealing with designated Iranian banks. It required them to contemplate the very significant business consequences that would result from being cut off from the United States if they chose to work with those two dozen Iranian banks that we had sanctioned. After Sassada's enactment, my colleagues and I fanned out around the globe to explain the new law, visiting or talking to government counterparts in over 50 countries and representatives from more than 150 foreign financial institutions. As we explained in these conversations, Sassada offered foreign banks a choice. They could do business with banks in the US, or they could do business with designated Iranian banks, but they could not do both. The impact was dramatic. Nearly everyone we spoke with readily recognized that there really was only one choice, to terminate relationships with designated Iranian banks. And those that did not appear to recognize this, like Kunlun Bank in China and Elaf Islamic Bank in Iraq, both of which have now been cut off from the United States banking system, have learned that we are quite serious about the choice to be made under Sassada. As I said, Sassada was novel and innovative, but it was not, as some have claimed, extraterritorial. It does not purport to regulate foreign banks. To the contrary, it provides authority to the Secretary of the Treasury to regulate US financial institutions, limiting our bank's ability to transact with certain foreign banks. Now, once Sassada was in place, we turned our attention to the Central Bank of Iran, the key to Iran's oil revenues, because under Iranian law, it was the only bank authorized to receive payments for Iran's oil sales. In the spring of 2011, we began discussing with our closest allies the possibility of imposing international sanctions on the CBI. We made the case that isolating the CBI was warranted because of the role it played in Iran's illicit activity, and that imposing specific sanctions on the CBI, the recipient of Iran's oil revenues, would be a particularly effective way to ramp up the pressure on Iran. Following through in November 2011, we issued a formal finding under what is known as Section 311 of the USA Patriot Act, that the entire jurisdiction of Iran, including the CBI, was a, quote, primary money laundering concern. In that finding, we focused on much more than Iran's abundant anti-money laundering deficiencies. In a key passage, we described the CBI's role in funneling billions of dollars to designated Iranian banks and in engaging in deceptive practices to conceal those payments. The same day that we acted, the UK and Canada took action to forbid almost all financial transactions between their banks and all Iranian banks, again including the CBI. The campaign to isolate the CBI was thus well underway. Then, a little over a month later, the President signed the National Defense Authorization Act for fiscal year 2012, known as the NDAA. This law set the stage for additional pressure against the CBI and Iran's oil revenues. The relevant provision of the NDAA, Section 1245, is quite complex. Let me try and describe it. It builds on the Sassada model by limiting direct access to the US financial system for foreign banks involved in paying the CBI for oil or other goods, unless the foreign bank's home country significantly reduces its oil imports from Iran. As I said, it's a complicated piece of legislation, so let me say that again. Section 1245 provides that foreign banks involved in significant transactions with the CBI, including making payments for Iranian oil, can be cut off from the United States banking system unless their home jurisdiction has significantly reduced its oil imports from Iran. So the purpose of the legislation is clear enough. It leverages foreign banks' desire to have access to the US financial system to drive down Iran's oil revenues. Section 1245 thus provides a powerful incentive for countries that import oil from Iran to reduce their imports. Namely, if they significantly reduce their Iranian oil imports, their banks will be protected for a period of time against the possibility of sanctions for transactions with the CBI. As we did after the enactment of Sassada, we have spent a great deal of time over the past 9 months meeting with foreign counterparts in both the public and private sectors to explain Section 1245, and along with our colleagues from the state and energy departments, to encourage importers of Iranian oil to protect their banks from sanction by significantly reducing their oil imports. And as in the aftermath of CESADA, the response has been quite positive. Every country that imported oil from Iran as of the beginning of this year has taken steps to significantly reduce the volume of their Iranian oil imports, driving down Iran's oil revenues. So that brings me back to where I began, with the impact of these measures on Iran. It is quite clear that the combined impact of the sanctions adopted over the last several years by the US and our partners around the world clearly got the attention of Iran's leadership. Taking aim at Iran's oil revenues, combined with squeezing Iran's access to the international financial system ever more tightly, created a dynamic that encouraged Iran to come to the negotiating table earlier this year. So along with Germany and the other permanent members of the UN Security Council, the so-called P5 plus one, we have met with the Iranians four times since April. We came to those meetings ready to explore a path to a negotiated resolution, but Iran's response to date has been a non-starter. We believe that while not limitless, there remains time and space for a diplomatic solution if Iran's leadership takes the strategic decision to make meaningful concessions. But let's be clear, the onus is clearly on Iran. And as we have clearly signaled all along, if Iran is not prepared to negotiate meaningfully about its nuclear program, we will increase the cost of Iran's intransigence. And that is precisely what we have done. At the end of July, the president issued an executive order imposing new sanctions on Iran. The order tightens the rules related to the payment for Iranian oil to make doubly sure that Iran is only able to sell oil to countries that are significantly reducing their imports of Iranian oil. It also tightens the rules regarding the sale of Iranian oil. Under the new order, any party that acquires oil from Iran, including brokers, traders, and other middlemen, is subject to sanctions, again, if that party is not located in a jurisdiction that is significantly reducing its oil imports from Iran. Moving beyond Iran's oil export, the new executive order authorizes sanctions against anyone involved in the import of petrochemicals from Iran, a multi-billion dollar industry for Iran, second only to its oil industry. And it also authorizes sanctions against anyone assisting Iran in acquiring precious metals, such as gold, as well as physical US currency. Then less than 2 weeks later, in early August, the president signed another piece of legislation, the Iran Threat Reduction Act, that builds on our robust sanctions regime. There are dozens of powerful provisions in this new law, but let me highlight just one. Section 504, seeks to limit what Iran can do with the revenue that it earns from its oil sales. In essence, Section 504 is designed to require Iran to deposit its oil revenue within the country in which it is earned, and to prevent Iran from moving that revenue around the global financial system or repatriating it to Iran. Because almost all of the countries that purchase oil from Iran run a significant trade deficit, that is, they import much more from Iran than they sell to Iran, the effect of this provision should be to lock up a significant portion of Iran's earnings in each of these countries. In short, as long as Iran continues to reject the path to a negotiated resolution, we will continue vigorously to pursue the pressure track. As I have tried to sketch out, we have in place now an enormously powerful set of sanctions at home and around the world. It retains its essential conduct-based foundation as it broadens out to target an ever more comprehensive set of Iranian financial and commercial activities. We will continue to devise new and enhanced sanctions so long as Iran refuses to address in a meaningful and productive way the very serious concerns with its nuclear program. And the impact from sanctions will only increase over time. As the financial sanctions continue to bite, the oil-related sanctions continue to drive down Iran's oil sales, potential workarounds are stymied, and our partners continue to take complementary action. We believe it is still possible to prevent Iran from achieving its goal through a combination of diplomatic and economic efforts. But while the diplomatic window is still open, there should be no doubt that it will not be open indefinitely, and that all options remain on the table to prevent Iran from obtaining a nuclear weapon. Thank you. So I have a few minutes to take questions. Sir.
I think you're doing a marvelous job, but don't you feel a little bit frustrated? Because if you measure the goals that you've set by, say, a gross domestic product, and you look at Western European countries like Italy, like Spain, like Greece, and like Portugal, their economies are sinking much faster than is Iran. So you must be wildly frustrated. You must be missing something.
Well, thank you for saying I'm doing a marvelous job, first of all. Our goal is not measured by Iran's gross domestic product. That is a indicator, I think, of the effect that we're having. And I think a more apt comparison is Iran versus its neighbors, other oil exporting countries in the Gulf region, where Iran is lagging far, far behind the GDP growth of these other countries. And as I indicated, I think we expect this year that Iran's GDP growth will in fact be negative. But the broader answer to your question is that, you know, our goal, as I said, isn't to affect their GDP growth, it's to affect their political calculus through a range of actions, including sanctions. On that dimension, I'm not frustrated. I'm not, I don't regard what we have accomplished thus far as being anything other than steps towards what we continue to believe to be a potential resolution to this problem. And so we, as I said, will continue along this path. We will look at indicators like GDP growth as one way to gain insight into whether we are having an effect. But ultimately, the goal here isn't negative GDP growth, it's a change in Iran's nuclear calculus.
So. You said that the window for diplomatic
As I said, the it's not indefinite, but I can't be any more specific than that. We are, as I said, continuing to offer to the Iranians the opportunity for engagement. We have, throughout the course of the last 6 months or so, made very clear to the Iranians that we, along with the P5 plus one, are prepared to meet to discuss their nuclear program, providing they are prepared to engage meaningfully with us. The width of that window is not something that I'm prepared to opine on. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Just a quick preface to my question. My name is Alice Labrie, and I'm former U.S. Department of State Foreign Service. I've served in Turkey and Oman, Sweden, and the U.S. mission under Richard Holbrooke. And my concern is, frankly, I'm scared. The more pressure we put on Iran, are we going to increase the odds for us having more terrorism here?
A big part of my job is counterterrorism. and particularly counterterrorist financing. One of the issues that we are watching very carefully is the risk of terrorist attacks from Iran, as well as from their proxies, Hezbollah in particular. You know, we have seen in the last 6 months, activity by Hezbollah. We've seen activity by the Quds Force that is quite concerning. I mean, I think the most prominent example of Iranian attempted terrorist activity was the plot that was revealed, I think, last September to try and assassinate the Saudi ambassador to the United States in Washington. So, I mean, the short answer to your question is absolutely. It's something that we are quite focused on. And you know, as I noted in my remarks, Iran remains the leading state sponsor of terrorism around the world today. So I don't think anyone ought to conclude that the Iranians would not at least consider responding through terrorist activity. That being said, our government has done a tremendous amount of work, and I think a tremendous amount of good work, to protect against terrorist activity. Again, I think the Arbab Siyar plot, the plot to assassinate the Saudi ambassador, is a good example. That plot was disrupted well before it was close to being executed. So although it is something to be concerned about, I think you should also be confident that we are working quite hard on that issue.
So I'm sort of curious as to what your eyes on the street tell you has actually happened in Iran, in the cities, to the business community, students, academic community, universities, government. What do we know in terms of real feedback as you, constantly put through this sort of mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think life has changed in a variety of ways, and in ways that I think reflect, in particular, the much more limited financial access that Iran has today. I think most importantly, and it's hard to see, and it's particularly hard to see if you don't get to see what I get to see. Is the impact on Iran's ability to finance the import of material that it needs, not just for its nuclear program, but for its industrial production. What the government needs in order to, to function and to provide what it wants to provide within Iran. It is much, much more difficult for Iran today to open a letter of credit, to make an international payment, to import the steel that it needs to import those sorts of raw materials. So we are seeing those sorts of impacts sort of reverberating through the Iranian economy. The depreciation of the rial has also had a tremendously powerful impact because the government of Iran, although it is trying to acquire dollars, trying to acquire gold, trying to acquire other forms of hard currency, principally has rials to spend. And as the rial has lost more than half of its value against the dollar in the last year, it is that much more difficult for Iran to pay for, and that much more expensive for Iran to acquire the materials that it's trying to acquire internationally.
Has that affected the scientific international community, the nuclear physicists? I mean, I understand what the president is doing and what the UN is doing, but it's not just the money and the gold. It's a mindset, and it's a different way of thinking about time. So while as rational as we would like to be, Hitler wasn't rational either. It was the generals who were a little psycho who knew what he was going to do and spoke to Bradley and Eisenhower and all those other people and say, he's not going to do that. He's going to do that. No, it's ridiculous. Well, that's what he did. because they were on the same wavelength. So do you have an assortment of people who are rational but creative, let's say, psychologically, to think that other kinds of assets can flow in different ways from other places that you're not thinking of? It's not just assets. It's a mindset. And the Ahmadinejad and his Ayatollah are not in the same ball game. They're not going to cry uncle.
The focus of our efforts is on the Iranian leadership. It's the Iranian leadership that controls the nuclear program, that is ultimately going to make the decision on where they will take their nuclear program, what they will tell their nuclear scientists to do or not to do. As I was saying before this event this evening, our policy at some level is premised on the assumption that at some level the Iranian leadership can be influenced, that they respond to incentives and disincentives, that what we are doing can affect how they approach their nuclear program. That's what we're trying to do. The, you know, whether it affects the particular nuclear scientist who's working on the program, I think is not exactly the question. The question is, can we affect the calculus of the Iranian leadership? I think the fact that the Iranians came back to the negotiating table this spring and came back in a way without preconditions, if you look back a couple of years, every time that the Iranians were willing to sit down with a P5+1, it always came with a long list of preconditions and other issues that they wanted to address. When the Iranians said this spring that they were willing to meet first in Istanbul and then in Baghdad and then in Moscow, it was not with a whole long list of preconditions. I think, as I said, our assessment is that that was generated in part, at least, because of a reaction to the pressure that we had been applying. So I think that reinforces our underlying premise that the Iranian leadership can be influenced. And you know, we will continue to try and do that.
The second part of my question.
Why don't we let somebody else do it?
He's coming to the General Assembly.
He is, yes.
And I think it's kind of scary. So can you anticipate anything people say?
No. I think I have time for one more question, so go ahead.
Just a two-part question. One, kind of a big question, just saying, in the future, do you see sanctions playing a bigger role than military in humanity or whatever scale of future you want to talk about? And then the second thing is, do you think there's been any black eyes on sanctions, or, you know, like in the past on sanctions to maybe create stalemates or black markets or anything like that? And do you have to overcome those objections with, let's say, countries or people that are more impatient, you know, saying that sanctions may not do much?
Those are both very broad questions. I'll try and answer those. In the future, will sanctions play a more prominent role than military action? I don't know. I must say, I hope so. One of the things that I think about often is that the sanctions that we're applying in Iran, in Syria, in other areas, have real impact. We are not blind to the fact that these are, you know, however much we try and do targeted sanctions and conduct-based sanctions, that there are, you know, broader systemic impacts from our sanctions. It's a heck of a lot better than a war. And, you know, we are doing what we can, whether it's in Iran, whether it's in Syria, what we did, you know, a year and a half ago now in Libya, to try and, you know, either avert or limit and bring an end to violence. And as I said, I think it's not, sanctions are not child's play. These are serious, powerful tools, but compared to the alternative, I think, at least my estimation, far better. The second part of your question is, in working with our international partners, do we sometimes find people who are more impatient or more skeptical? Of course. Part of what we do on a day in, day out basis is work with partners around the world to share our perspective, learn from them, talk about what we're seeing as impact, what we're seeing as effects, and tailor our programs as a result. But it's a big and complicated world, and different countries have different perspectives. But we're working with lots of people on these efforts. So I need to
thank you all for coming.
Thank you all.